excited to be able to sit down and to really share the applied educational neuroscience framework with educators. This is a trauma responsive framework, but it also is deeply rooted in how we need to begin to rewire our perceptions of discipline, whether that is in the classroom, whether that's with administrators, taking the lead, or in our homes and communities. So I'm going to take a deep breath, and I'm going to begin giving you an overview of what applied educational neuroscience is about. First of all, it is absolutely a framework. It is not a program. This framework is built on four pillars, and I'm going to be talking about each of those throughout this series today, not only what they are, but also what do they look like in our classrooms and schools. So to begin with, when we think about a framework, it has a thousand faces in different classrooms, in different buildings, whether administrators are addressing this framework with their staff, which is their classroom, or classroom teachers are addressing this framework whole class, small group, or one-on-one. So it's not scripted. It, again, has a place in how we begin to rewire our perceptions of how we see, view, and then implement discipline in our schools and in our homes. So I want to talk about trauma and adversity in general for just a minute. What we are learning today and what this framework really talks about and how it informs us is body awareness. What we understand today is that trauma and adversity happen on a continuum. There can be small accumulating adversities that add up into significant traumas in the developing brain and body. And the last piece of this is the body. Trauma is body overwhelm. It is when information comes in too fast, too much, and too soon. It's a nervous system and physiological challenge. And our children, as those brains and as those bodies and stress response systems develop, are more vulnerable to these accumulating stressors. As I'm creating this series of videos right now, we are COVID-19 teaching. It is the end of August 2020, and our children and adolescents have been away from school for approximately 6 months. So as I'm sitting here creating this, we have teachers who are hybrid teaching, we have teachers who are virtually teaching, and then we have face-to-face. And currently, I am back in the classroom, and I am in a third and fourth grade classroom working with educators who are teaching hybrid. I've never in my life seen anything more challenging. It's challenging for the students. It's super challenging for educators and parents. So as we think about this framework in present time and looking at future and where we've been, the very first pillar I want to address is educator brain and body wellness. Educator brain and body state. It begins with us. And this is what I'm learning as I move through this work over the last few years. As a parent, as a teacher, when I am dysregulated, I cannot regulate a child. When I have unintentionally jumped into a power struggle and into a conflict cycle, I am unable to model the behaviors that I want to see and to be able to share my calm with my child or with my adolescent. And I can say to everyone today, if I had known this work when Andrew, Sarah, and Reagan were little, I would have been a very different mom. So this is not just about the teaching and learning process in our schools. It is about parenting, and it reflects and it really hits upon all relationships in our lives. So educator brain and body state is our first pillar, and we're making sure that we are calm before we begin to talk to a child who's made a poor choice or we begin to address discipline issues. I take my deep breaths, I get a drink of water, I give myself some space and some time, and I know that when my nervous system is calm, that has contagion for the children, emotional contagion for the children I sit beside. So as I move into schools and districts around the country, we spend a very significant amount of time looking at how administrators can begin to implement these practices with their staff so that we are modeling the behaviors that teachers want to begin to implement with students. And again, we know that traditional discipline works the best with the kids who need it the least, and it works the least with the kids who need it the most. The second pillar of this work is co-regulation. I don't really like the word regulation, but you could use the word co-grounding, co-settling, sharing your calm, emotionally available, stable presence. And oftentimes, that's without words. Because what we understand today is that 93% of our communication in any moment is nonverbal. Our children and adolescents are reading our words, they're watching our posture, they're looking at how we gesture, and they're listening to our tones. The third pillar of this work are touch points. And touch points are when we strengthen relationships. Touch points can be 2 seconds long, a minute long, 10 minutes long, and it's when we are intentional about how we are addressing relationships. It's how we greet a child when they walk in the morning. It's the look on our face, sharing our gentle gaze. It's noticing a new haircut, noticing a tattoo, a pair of tennis shoes. It's validating a child when they are rough, when they are almost reaching that point of no return. It's asking questions to learn and not to respond. The fourth pillar of this work is teaching our children about the science beneath their behaviors. When they understand that nothing is wrong with them, that they're not a bad kid, and they have a brain that is neurobiologically wired to respond to experiences, that feels empowering and it feels relieving. So we are using the language of science. We're talking about the prefrontal cortex. We're talking about the amygdala. We're talking about that little hippocampus that shares memory experiences, that monitors stress regulation, that's a part of our learning. And then most of all, we're talking about the greatest superhuman power there is, and that is neuroplasticity. And neuroplasticity is the brain and body's ability to change moment by moment with every single experience that is in front of that brain. So that brain changes structurally, meaning new connections are wiring up, and it changes functionally. So this work is also about resiliency, because this framework, applied educational neuroscience, doesn't leave it just at being trauma responsive. It talks about the resiliency of the human brain and body. Our brains are built to return to homeostasis. We know that that brain and body can repair and can heal. And we have that ability to do so, but especially when we are feeling felt by another and feeling connected with another. I also want to share with you that discipline is contextually what this framework is addressing. We understand today that many of our children who are punished in traditional ways, when we yell, when we nag, when we threaten, when we are talking at a child, when we are escalated and the child is escalated, we are actually and unintentionally re-traumatizing that child or that adolescent. So I'm very excited to share this framework with you, and I hope you'll enjoy the series of videos that we will be addressing in the next few parts.